Okay, good. So good morning. So today it's my last lecture. So yesterday we did this whole theory of asymptotic symmetries, and I told you everything that you need to do and check in order to. So it was again very formal. So I wanted to give a couple interesting examples of asymptotic symmetric groups and so on. And the point is that there is very little time, so I'm going to do a little marathon. So first I'm going to present for you the asymptotic symmetries of ADS3, which are sort of started in the Q&A session yesterday, and then time permitting. So the goal is to reach and surpass that blackboard over there. Which I think is a good opportunity for you to learn by heart the asymptotic expansion of asymptotically flat spacetimes. So you just stare at it when you don't stare at me, and then something will catch. Okay, so yesterday I had started speaking about this Feffman-Graham expansion. So basically, what you do, you start solving the asymptotic Einstein equations with a negative cosmological constant, and the general solution takes this form. Okay, it's a bit more general in higher dimensions. This is for this is in three dimensions. So there's so you're basically working in this Feffman-Graham gauge, which is like a radial gauge. So the ZZ component is this, no Z alpha components, and then the Einstein equation restricts this Z dependence of the alpha beta piece of the metric, and basically the point G0 appearing at the coefficient of 1 over Z squared. G2 is constrained, so it's trace, which is taken with respect to G0, is determined by the Ricci scalar of G0, and then it also satisfies this constraint. And then everything else, as I said, it sort of depends on the matter content of your theory. If you have pure gravity, you have something that you know. If you have matter, then these things are not universal. But these two pieces are universal. And as some people were pointing out at the end of the lecture, it is indeed true that this only determines the this G0 determines the boundary metric only up to a normal conformal factor, because this is how we define this conformal boundary up to an overall rescaling, and so the spacetimes are going to be called asymptotically ADS if G0 is conformal to the Minkowski metric, and asymptotically locally ADS if it's some arbitrary metric. I guess in two dimensions it doesn't matter, but in higher dimensions that's the case. Okay, so now what we want to do, we basically want to fix the Dirichlet boundary conditions. So we fix G0, and moreover we fix G0 to be eta alpha beta, and then we want to solve what the phase space is. So what are the most general solutions to these equations? So we want to fix G0 alpha beta to be eta alpha beta. So the boundary metric is, so I'm going to write, use either phi and t coordinates, or dx plus dx minus, where x plus minus are phi plus minus t. Okay, so these null coordinates will actually be very natural. So in terms of null coordinates, this eta alpha beta is 0, a half. And so now we want to solve this equation, and then you see, because G0 upper, so eta upper is 0, 2, 2, 0. So we get the G2 plus minus equal to 0, because the Ricci scalar is 0 of G0, and then we also get something like d plus of G2 minus minus. So that's the plus equation over here, equal to 0, this thing is 0, equals d minus G2 plus plus equal to 0. Okay, So these guys come basically from solving the asymptotic Einstein equation. So if we want to be on shell, we'd better solve it. And the solutions are kind of obvious. So G2 plus plus is an arbitrary function of x plus, and G2 minus minus is an arbitrary function, some other arbitrary function of x minus. Okay. And so the gravitational phase space in presence of these boundary conditions is parameterized by an arbitrary function of x plus, an arbitrary function of x minus, and whatever the matter fields are doing, matter data. So again, the matter fields, we most likely want to impose Dirichlet boundary conditions on the matter fields, so we're going to also have some sort of functions that parameterize the matter fields, but we don't care. We're mostly interested in what the gravitational part does, but it's important to stress that this matter can be turned on and it's going to appear in the back reaction on the metric over here. Okay. So now we want to look at the asymptotic diffeomorphisms. So remember that yesterday I had defined the allowed diffeomorphism as those diffeomorphisms that preserve the boundary conditions. And it's sort of clear from here that if I want to preserve the eta alpha beta, then I need to consider a diffeomorphism that's asymptotically a conformal killing vector of the metric. Because this guy will pick up a scale factor which can be absorbed into Z. So that's a bit the idea. So asymptotically, so want the alpha chi beta plus d beta chi alpha is e to alpha beta to be proportional to eta, and the proportional constant is, by just contracting the thing. And if you just plug in this form of the metric, then you see that, what do you see? So eta plus plus is zero, so d plus chi lower plus equal to d minus chi lower minus equal to zero, because eta has zeros over here. And so this implies that this guy is just a function of x minus, and this guy is just a function of x plus, and that's it. We don't get any. The plus minus is just an identity, so we don't care. Okay. Therefore, now you take this asymptotic. So these guys are basically the asymptotic piece of the diffeomorphisms. But now we have to complete them into the bulk to get the Z dependence and all of that. And the result of doing that is the following. So we have two sets of diffeomorphisms. I'm going to call this guy left, which are going to be chi left of x plus, which is basically x lower minus. It's basically x upper plus, which is a function of x plus from this equation. And then looking at the lower z terms, we find the chi left prime of x plus z dz. I'm sorry, I have to erase this because minus L squared z squared over 2 chi left double prime of x plus d minus plus dot dot dot, where the dot dot dots are basically trivial diffeomorphism. This the lower pieces in the diffeomorphism will never contribute to the asymptotic charges, so because of their z dependence basically. So I just don't write them. So is it clear what I've done? This guy is basically the asymptotic part of, it was basically chi lower minus over here. Okay, good. And then this guy, chi lower plus, is going to be a chi upper minus, so it multiplies a d minus, and I'm going to call it chi right of, sorry. Yeah. These are, of course, the functions of x minus plus a half chi raf prime of x minus z dz minus l squared z double prime of x minus d plus plus dot dot dot. Okay, so this is, these are basically the asymptotic diffeos. So including all the dot dot dots are they allowed? But I'm telling you that these guys are trivial. So these are the asymptotic diffeos that preserve these boundary conditions on the ADS tree method. Now, I have to give you some information about the charges. So I told you that in order to use the formalism I give you, you need to plug stuff into Mathematica. But so I need to give you. So if you actually compute the charges using the formula that I gave you, and they turn out to be integrable, and then you integrate them, then you find that Q associated to xi left is 1 over 8 pi gl integral from. So now I'm making the boundary compact, this phi on the boundary compact, d phi. L of x plus chi left of x plus, and then the charges associated to xi right are given by the same thing with an L bar of x minus here and chi right of x minus. And there's a minus in front. Maybe I should have written it. Anyways. So what's the only thing that you have to be careful about here, it's like, I mean, is that these L's are defined here in Pfeffermann-Graham gauge. So in principle, you can consider any asymptotically ADS tree metric. You don't need to work in this gauge. But if you want to use the formula that I gave you, which were computed in a particular gauge with this particular definition of L, then you have to put your metric in Pfeffermann-Graham gauge. If you have a computer with you, then you can plug in any metric that's asymptotically ADS tree and can do, well, any allowed thing in the mixed R or Z something directions, that's also fine. But since you don't have a computer, then you stick to this. And now if you want to, you know, evaluate different things, you can now just take different spacetimes, which have some values of L and L bar, and just compute asymptotic charges with respect to them. So for example, if you take, if you want to compute the energy, dt, so just from the definition of x plus minus, dt is d plus minus d minus. Okay? So just from here. So you're setting chi left equal to 1 here, and chi right equals to minus 1 over here. So basically, what you're going to find is that q dt is integral, so 8 pi gl integral d phi L of x plus L bar of x minus. Okay, so you're just picking up the zeros of these L's and L bars. If you want to compute the angular momentum, that's q d phi. D phi is d plus plus d minus. So you're gonna get the same thing but with a minus over here. You want to compute, say, the energy of global ADS. So let's just do an example. ADS 3. So the metric was L squared minus cos squared of rho d tau squared plus d rho squared plus sin squared of rho d phi squared. As I said, in order to be able to use this formula, you first need to go to Pfeffermann-Graham gauge in order to be able to read L and L bar. So to do that, you basically... So you see that this is already some sort of radial gauge. So you just need to replace this d rho squared by dz over z squared. And then you solve, and then you find that z is some constant times e to the minus rho. And you plug it in, and so you need to write the cosh and the sinh in terms of z. So by appropriately choosing the constant, this is 1 over z plus z over 4 And this is 1 over z minus z over 4, something like that, squared. Okay, because it's e to the plus minus rho, that's why I get them, and the constant is 2. And then, so basically, in order to extract the L and L bars, you just need the coefficients. So the 1 over z term, you see that from here, it just gives you d phi squared minus d tau squared. So that's nice, that's the boundary metric that you wanted. So this is why I fixed this coefficient to, I think it's 2 here, it's either 2 or a half, okay? And then in order to get the L's and the L bars, basically you need to get the term that goes like z to the 0, because this is what I have over there. And that term, so you're picking up I don't have a lot of place to write. So you have L squared d phi squared minus d tau squared over z squared. And then, damn it. I'm going to write over here, and I apologize for. Okay, so the coefficient of the constant is going to be a minus 1/2 d tau squared from here, and then I have another minus 1/2 d phi squared, with an L squared in front, from here, L squared over 2, L squared over 2. So you're writing this as minus L squared over 4 d tau plus d phi squared plus d tau minus d phi squared. Okay? And now you see this is dx plus squared, dx minus squared, so L and L bar are both minus L squared over 4, and now you plug them into the mass formula. This is a mess. Okay. So, so for global ADS, L equals L bar equals minus L squared over 4. And now I plug them into QDT, which was 1 over 8 pi GL integral d phi L plus L bar. And I get that this gives me a 2 pi, so it's minus 2 pi L squared over 8 pi GL times 4. Which is, because I have 2 of them. Okay? So which is minus L over 8 G. Okay? In principle, this number doesn't mean anything, because I told you that in our formalism, the zero point of the energy wasn't fixed. We had to integrate from a reference background whose energy we'd choose. However, there exist formalisms such as holographic renormalizations, which do give you the zero point of the energy. So here we fixed it, we just said that the energy of L equals L bar equal to 0 is fixing. But it turns out that even in formalisms where you can get the correct zero point energy, like you can determine it what it is, that's the correct choice. Okay? So this number actually does have a meaning. And when you do, so later we're going to do the HG analysis, we're going to find some Virasoro with the center charge 3L over 2G. So this is minus C over 12, is that correct? That's minus C over 12, which can anybody recognize what this energy is? Very good. So it's the Casimir energy of the CFT vacuum on the cylinder. So that's going to be Poincaré ADS. Yeah, which has very good. So this was just to give you an idea how you actually compute. But okay, you can also compute QD5 for the ADS vacuum. Can anybody say what this is? Yeah, but how much is it for a global lid? Zero. Because it's L minus L bar, which is zero. Okay? So, and in the notes, I have some example with conical defects. I mean, you can just compute this whichever way you want. At the end of the day, okay, so you have the vacuum. You have this conical defect space times. Which basically their metric is the same as the ADS metric, except that phi is not identified mod 2 pi, but mod 2 pi alpha, where alpha is smaller than 1. And then you can compute their energies and find that you get an alpha squared over here. So they have still negative energies, but smaller in absolute value. And then you have these BTZ black holes. You can read about them in like a zillion references, including in Geoffrey's lecture notes. And those guys have positive mass and an angular momentum bounded by the mass. So basically, the spectrum of solutions that have like nice killing vectors, like dt and dphi, killing vectors in ADS3 look something like this. So this is the zero energy, the vacuum. Okay, so what I'm plotting is m versus J of the solutions. So we just saw that the vacuum is sitting over here, minus C over 12, and, okay, maybe you'll write it, minus L over 8G, and zero angular momentum. Then you have your conical defects, which are sitting somewhere over here, still at negative energy. And then you have the BTZ black holes, which have a mass larger than mod of the angular momentum, and are sitting somewhere over here. Okay, so Poincaré vacuum does have L equal to L bar equal to zero, and also the spectrum of BTZs reaches up to that point. Okay, so this is roughly what, okay, this is our solutions with isometries. The general solutions are going to be parameterized by arbitrary functions, actually. So, okay, very good. So this is how you do these calculations. Now I wanted to talk about asymptotic symmetries. So in order to talk about asymptotic symmetries, it's useful. So I'm on the cylinder. So my ADS spatial coordinate is compact with the period 2 pi. So it's natural to label this function, so this will be periodic functions, because x plus is well tau plus phi, and I want to consider a basis of functions which are e to the I m x plus, okay, and similarly here I want to consider e to the apparently I want to consider minus e to the I m x minus. This is just the basis of function, and then so as I told you yesterday, in order to know what the algebra of the conserved charges is, you have this representation theorem, which relates it to the Lie bracket algebra of the associated diffeomorphisms. So if I want to know the algebra of the charges that I wrote over there, I can just compute the Lie brackets of these guys. And and that's done using either Mathematica, or you take a little bit of time to do it. But I don't have it, so I just write the result. The result is that xm left with xn left. So now I'm parameterizing them by this. So I'm taking this representative and the representative with an n here is minus I m minus n xi left m plus n plus order z to the. So this is just an asymptotically algebra, if you want. The Lie bracket asymptotically relates these vectors, but then there are all the dot dot dots that that you still need to take care of, and the same for the right movers. So the right guys also satisfy this algebra, and xi left with xi right commute. Okay. You can just plug it into your computer and check. And can anybody tell me what this algebra is? It's the Witt algebra or centerless Virasoro. Okay, very good. So in principle, we should find that that our conserved charges satisfy also this algebra. So from the representation theorem, I told you that Q eta with Q xi. So this is the representation theorem. Is there some question? Okay. Which is defined to be del xi of q eta should be q of plus some central extension. So this bracket basically proves that what you're going to get here is m minus n. So if this is m, so if you take eta to be xi left m, and this xi to be xi left n, then you're going to get m minus n. So you're going to get this Witt part coming here. But now we want to see whether there is a central extension to the algebra, which would be very interesting. And for this, we actually need to do the computation of the variation of the charge. We cannot use the representation theorem because it doesn't give it to us. Okay, so the charge is this. So let me just do it for the left movers. For the right movers, it's exactly the same. So if I want to compute so q eta left with q xi, say left, so it's delta xi left q eta left. And from this expression for the charges, I find 1 over 8 pi gl integral d phi of the variation under xi left of this function L of x plus times, so I'm looking at q eta left. So this guy is going to be the chi, the function chi associated to eta left. Okay? So each of these diffeomorphisms is parameterized by one asymptotic function of just x plus, and this is what I have. Right? So this is just definition. And here I'm just plugging in. And this guy, the way that I'm computing this is I'm basically taking the full metric and I'm acting with this xi left diffeomorphism on the full metric, asymptotically ADS3 metric. And then this diffeomorphism is designed to preserve the Pfefferman-Graham gauge. That's important. Okay? And then I'm just reading off what the new L is after I act with this diffeomorphism on the metric. So I start with a metric that has an L in it, L of x plus. I act with this diffeomorphism on it. The result is going to be also obeying Pfefferman-Graham gauge because I've arranged for these terms in the diffeo to preserve for me the Pfefferman-Graham gauge. And then I just read off what the variation. So since in Pfefferman-Graham gauge, it's clear that the only thing that can change are L and L bar. And I'm just writing the new L. And the new L, so the variation of the L, is 2, the old L, the chi associated to xi left prime of x plus, plus the chi associated to xi left of x plus times L prime of x plus minus L squared over 2 chi associated to xi left of x plus triple prime. Okay? So this again, you go and take whatever program you're using to do GR, and you do this deformation on the metric to read off what this thing is. Okay. So now, what I want to do, I want to integrate this term by parts in order to get an L. So what I'm getting is 1 over 8 pi g L. And since I'm on a circle, then I can just drop the boundary terms because everything is, all the functions are periodic. So I get d phi, and then I get 2 L chi xi left prime chi eta left. And now I'm picking a minus chi xi left chi eta left prime times L from the integration by parts minus L squared over 2 chi xi left triple prime chi eta left, and close the parentheses. Okay? So notice that this term is not multiplied by L. Right? It was just coming from the diffeo. And now this term, you can easily see that it's just L times chi xi left prime chi eta left minus chi eta left prime chi xi left. Or this function is precisely the function that appears when I take So if I'm looking at the Lie bracket of these two diffeomorphisms, parameterized by chi xi left and chi eta left, when I take their Lie bracket, the leading function appearing in the Lie bracketed diffeomorphism is precisely this one. Okay? And if I work in the basis, M and N basis, it's going to be precisely that guy, M minus N, xi, M plus N. Okay? So basically here I've checked the representation theorem. I've checked the fact that indeed, so this one is basically this term. Okay? But I've also gotten something new, and that something new is this term over here. This is the central extension. And if I'm plugging M and N's into the expression, then I'm labeling now the charges by M and N because it's so much simpler. The commutators that I'm getting is Q left M with Q left N is minus I M minus N Q left M plus N. So let's do this one carefully. So I'm picking very good. So the M is eta, and N is xi. Okay? So what I'm picking up here is minus L squared over 2 times 8 pi GL. And then I have chi xi triple prime, so that's I n cubed, and then this guy, and when I do the integral, I'm just gonna pick up something like 2 pi delta m plus n. And this term. So now I want to. So actually, I'm doing the calculation correctly. So this term is going to be I L over 8g n cubed, but n is minus m, so I'm picking a minus il over 8g m cubed delta m plus n. Okay? And now, okay, very good. So this is what I'm getting. This is the charge algebra. Okay, so you see that I'm getting a central extension, which looks like this. And then in order to write something more recognizable, I want to pass from these Dirac brackets, which are the classical brackets, I want to pass to commutators. So when I do that, so the commutator is IH bar times the classical bracket, let's call it Dirac bracket. And then, okay, let me set h bar to 1 just to not bother. So at the end, you're going to see that this guy is minus I times the commutator, so I can just drop all the minus signs on the right-hand side. And what I'm getting, and then I'm writing q left m, I'm going to rewrite them as lms. And what I'm finding is lm with ln commutator is m minus n Lm plus n plus L over 8g m cubed delta m plus n. Okay? And here I guess you can recognize the Virasoro algebra with the central extension. So this thing in Virasoro is supposed to be C over 12. So you can see that the central charge of the Virasoro is just 3L over 2G. You might complain that usually the Virasoro is written as M cubed minus M over here, but that's trivial, that's actually not a... That's something that you can just get by shifting the value of L0. So I won't write it. So the non-trivial part is this m cubed term, and we can just read off the central charge from it. So you see how... So I guess what's nice about this is that you're doing a completely classical calculation of some, you know, algebra of conserved charges. And this completely classical calculation tells you something quantum about... Well, of course, now we know that there's ADACFT about the dual theory. It gives you the central charge. So given that we're, you know, in order to be able to trust, so this thing, G is basically L Planck. In three dimensions, you have to be careful about factors of H bar. So I think, to be more correct, there's a factor of H bar over here. So basically, this is 3L over 2L Planck. So you see, this number is really, really huge in order for you to be able to trust the approximation. Okay, good. So this is what I wanted to show. So this is how this calculation works. So we basically did all this asymptotic symmetric group business. We fixed the boundary metric. We described the phase space. We described the, asymptotic diffeomorphisms that are allowed and that act non-trivially, and then we computed their algebra, we checked the representation theorem, and we also found this nice non-trivial central extension, which in every single example of ADS-CFT, where people can actually compute something in the CFT, it matches the central charge of the dual CFT. Comments? Okay, so this thing is very, very special to three dimensions. If you're trying to compute the asymptotic symmetries of higher dimensional ADS spacetimes, you saw from the Pfeffermann-Graham thing that basically the asymptotic symmetries, so the way we constructed these xis, their leading term had to act like a conformal symmetry on the boundary metric. And the reason that we got all these nice infinite infinite dimensional symmetry group over here is because because you have an infinite number of solutions in two dimensions, and that's not happening in higher dimensions. So in higher dimensions, you If you do this, you're just going to get an asymptotic symmetry group, which is the same as the isometry group of the ADS vacuum. Okay, so it's SOD, 2. So sometimes people say that ADS CFT, in order to check it, you match the symmetries of ADS to the symmetries of the CFT. That's not exactly what you're supposed to be doing. You're supposed to match the asymptotic symmetries of ADS to the symmetries of the CFT. In higher dimensions, it really doesn't make a difference because the asymptotic symmetries of ADS are the same as the isometries of the vacuum, but in 3D, the asymptotic symmetries are infinidimensional, whereas the isometries of the vacuum are just SO 2,2. You get 6 Killing vectors. So that's a distinction. I guess this is all that I wanted to say about this case. Are there any questions? Yes. So the question was, in cases where when you have a duality between a theory of quantum gravity in ADS and some sort of string theory example, this C turns out to be the central charge of the dual CFT, which is a particular theory. However, you can also just quantize. It turns out that in principle you can just quantize this 3D gravity by itself. I'm not sure if the dual is actually known, but it's but that theory, if you're just doing pure gravity, it turns out that you get some non-trivial connected contribution from the two boundary partition function. So that indicates that this pure gravity in three dimensions, if it's dual to something, it should be somehow dual to an ensemble average of CFTs. And the question was whether this C is some sort of, what does it represent? I would guess all of them would have sort of the same. The short answer is that I don't know. And maybe the reason is that I'm not sure if there's any precise proposal for what you're supposed to average over, but I'm not completely sure. But then I would guess it's maybe they all have the same central charge, and I'm not sure exactly what you're averaging over in that case. I should look up. I'm not sure there's any precise proposal, but I should look it up. But one important comment that this brings up is that. So people use this sort of asymptotic symmetry group calculations to say to do some sort of to try to explain the entropy of black holes that have an ADS3 near horizon region. So you might have some sort of five-dimensional black hole or whatnot. In the near horizon, it's ADS3. It's actually a BTZ black hole in the near horizon. And then you do an asymptotic symmetry group analysis to read off the central charge of the whole CFT. Just from gravity, and then you can sort of do some black hole thermodynamics. You compute the area, and you find that the entropy of the black hole, which is just given by definition by the area of the event horizon, can be written as a so-called Cardy formula, which is a formula for the high temperature entropy in a two-dimensional CFT, which is derived using modular invariance. So, whereas that works very well for theories that are dual to specific realizations of like in string theory, when you have a definite theory that works and so on. In the case of this pure gravity dual to some sort of In the case of pure gravity, it's not clear whether the area of the event horizon is really counting any sort of microstates. And it's a little bit difficult to make sense of the modular properties of this set. So you can take your partition function and then try to sum over modular images, partition function for pure gravity, and you sum over modular images in order to find. And then that partition function has some very, very weird properties that people couldn't make sense of. So this is why I was saying that pure gravity versus string theory realizations are very different. A lot of the intuition that we have and a lot of the words that we attach to these asymptotic symmetry groups, giving us the central charge of the dual CFT and the area, giving us the number of log of the number of microstates of the dual thing, are for a single instance for definite theories. But it's interesting to understand the other thing, but it seems to be very, very different. Yeah. Okay, good. Any other questions? Maybe I could make a comment. So here we're fixing the boundary metric, which is sort of the most natural thing to do in ADS, given this Pfeffermann-Graham expansion. But you can do other things. You can have mixed boundary conditions in ADS, where you fix some nonlinear combination of this G0 and G2. And doing that, you can still work out what happens. But just changing these boundary conditions on the metric actually does a lot of violence to the dual theory. So you can show that the dual theory becomes non-local if you change the boundary conditions from Dirichlet to something that mixes these two guys. So you can still track it, but I guess the point that I want to make is that the boundary conditions are really part of the definition of the theory. You change the boundary conditions, you get something very, very different. Even though it might look innocuous over here, and even though you can do your asymptotic symmetry group analysis, you might find Virasoros, but those Virasoros might mean something very, very different from how we want to interpret them in this case. Okay, good. So I guess I have a bit less than an hour to talk about flat space. So I guess the idea, I think there's no way I'm going to finish. I'll try to get to that board and maybe say a few words about it. And if I don't finish, which is for sure, you can just read the rest in Geoffrey's lecture notes, which I'm following pretty much. But this is another really interesting case of infinite extension of the the asymptotic symmetric group is not just the isometries of the vacuum but an infinite extension. So asymptotic symmetries of flat space. And why are we interested? Well, we're interested because we sort of live in flat space. We don't really live in flat space because we live in asymptotically the sitter, but to a good approximation if we don't go very far. But we're not too close. We live in flat space. And this is also interesting from the point of view of conserved charges because in this case it's physical for radiation to leave the space-time. So one wants to describe that. And okay, the asymptotic symmetries are very rich, and also they lead to observable effects. So people are thinking of measuring the effects of asymptotic symmetries. So that's always nice, connect to the real world. And also in the past few years, there's been a lot of activity relating the asymptotic symmetries of flat space to soft theorems in quantum field theory. So that has been a very, of course, I won't get to that. But there's a book written by Strominger. There are a lot of nice lecture notes that you can find. We just had one on TPHT by Andrea Pum, but there are others. So if you're interested, you're welcome to look at it. So again, just to set up the stage, I think it's good to discuss the Penrose diagram of Minkowski, without which, So I'm going to start with just empty Minkowski. And just to understand, you know, the propagation of fields on it and its causal structure, we're going to construct the Penrose diagram. So to do this, so basically we want to bring infinity to a finite distance, and the metric should look like something nice and finite up to a conformal factor that blows up. So I'm going to introduce this null coordinates, t minus r and t plus r. This is called retarded time, and this is called advanced. And u and v are between minus and plus infinity, with u smaller than or equal than v. Okay. So in terms of these coordinates, the metric looks like minus du dv from this piece, plus, and then r is u minus v over 2 squared d omega squared. Okay? And now, as in the end, in this case, we want to play a trick to make this coordinate range compact, to bring it to finite distance, and that's achieved by the tangent function. Okay, so now u and v are going to be between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2, with, again, u smaller or equal than v. So in terms of this u and v, ds squared is 1 over 4. I mean, you can do the algebra, but I guess it's understandable. So u minus v is going to be tan minus tan. So tan minus tan is going to give you a sine of u minus v over cos u cos v, something like that. So now this is why you're getting these factors. Cos squared of v minus 4 du dv. I mean, from here, this is d big u by cos squared of big u and so on. So you're picking up this sine squared of u minus v d omega squared. Okay? And the last manipulation that one does is one calls this thing minus r, and one introduces t. Yeah, okay, let me write them here. So one introduces t, which is u plus v, and r, which is v minus u. So this guy belongs to minus pi and pi, just from there, and this guy, using this property, belongs to 0 to pi, right? Because we had u smaller than v, so r is positive. But we have a relation, which is the fact that r plus mod t is actually smaller than pi. Which you can see, I think it's either going to be 2u or 2v, so it's clearly going to be smaller than pi, and it's clearly positive. Okay, very good. So now we can actually make a drawing of what this thing looks like. Before I do that, let me remark that... sorry, 4 du dv. So dt squared minus dr squared. Okay, very good. So this, you can also check that it is minus dt squared plus dr squared. Okay? So this is going to be sine squared of r. So the question is, what is this space? where R runs between 0 and pi. Yeah, what is this part of the space? Dr squared plus sine squared of R d omega 2 squared. Can people read what I wrote? So this one's a two sphere, and then this thing is what? Very good. So this thing is a three sphere, and then we have time that sort of sits there for the ride. So we have to draw a cylinder representing the three sphere. Which looks a lot like the ADS cylinder that I drew, but actually it's not at all the same. Because in ADS, what we're getting over here, if you remember, was half a sphere. So this thing was a disk. Here, our S3 just lives on the boundary of the cylinder. Okay? So that's what locally the metric looks like, but now we need to take care of these coordinate ranges. In particular, this constraint. So T runs this way, and R is just going to run along the cylinder. So if I put R equal to 0 here, and R equal to pi over here, so at R equal to 0, T goes from minus pi and pi. So maybe I would need some chalk. So T goes from minus pi and pi. At R equal to pi, T has to be 0, right? So this is T equal to 0 over here. And then you see what I'm doing. This thing translates into some sort of, this is so difficult to draw. What did I do over here? So, let me do this. Okay, let me put the minus pi over here because I just couldn't draw this thing. Okay, so actually what I'm drawing, sorry, and this is supposed to be somewhere on my cylinder, or if not, I just do it like this. Okay, very good. So what am I drawing? The thing that I'm drawing, so here is the line R equal to 0, and then I'm just doing basically a triangle that's covering this part, and then whatever it does on the other side. This part, do you see? It's basically like a diamond wrapping the cylinder. The fact that I drew a diamond is actually very confusing. So here, each point, because for each R, we're still having an S2. So each point is supposed to be an S2. So each point is supposed to be an S2. Except that in the way that people draw this diagram, actually you have two points corresponding to S2 because instead of drawing a triangle, which is what you get from here, you're drawing a diamond. So S2 starts here and ends here. Okay? Okay, so this is... this is what you get from these constraints. And if you sort of unwrap it and get rid of this doubling that you didn't need to do in the first place anyways, you get something like this. So here is the line R equal to 0. So this is the point T equal to pi, T equals minus pi at R equal to 0. And then we're getting this. So this is the point T equal to 0. Maybe I should have done this from the beginning, R equal to pi. OK? And then one gives names to these points. These are the points on the, on the manifold that we get in the conformal compactification. So this is an unphysical manifold whose metric is related via conformal transformation, basically this factor that we're throwing out. So Einstein's equation don't hold in here and la la la, but it's just useful for seeing the causal structure of the space. Okay? So on this unphysical manifold, one gives names to this thing. You have I plus, I minus, I zero, and scry plus and scry minus. It should be self-explanatory where they are. So I plus, it's called future time-like infinity. So it's the point on the diagram which has t equal to pi, r equal to zero. Okay, this is how I define it. And if you're trying to track back this coordinate transformation back to the physical t and r, t equal to pi, r equal to zero, basically it corresponds to the physical time going to infinity with r fixed. Is this clear? So what I'm doing, I'm taking this point, which basically corresponds to u and v, both going to pi over 2, roughly speaking, and then I'm doing the arc tang, and then I'm finding this. Okay? In physical coordinates. Okay? And what's the physical interpretation of this point is that all time-like geodesics end up here, which should be obvious from this. Well, not the fact that they all end up there, but the fact that time-like geodesics should have something to do with this should be clear. Then you have I minus, which is past. So all time-like geodesics and here, I minus is the past time-like infinity. So on the diagram, it's just defined as t equals minus pi, r equal to zero. And in physical spaces, t goes to minus infinity, r fixed. And the point is that all time-like geodesics start here. So basically, if I take any geodesic in my real space and I plot it, what it would look on this funny space, it would look something like this, time-like geodesics. Any of them would start here and end up here. And then you have spatial infinity, so I zero, which is the point over here. It's so it's called space-like infinity, it's t equal to zero, r equal to pi. And then if you go through your coordinate transformations, you see that you're sending r to infinity with t fixed, which would explain the name. So basically all space-like geodesics, and here, and then, more interestingly for us, you have this scry plus and minus, which are called future or past null infinity. So basically, these are not points, but they are null three-dimensional surfaces. So remember that I'm having spheres floating all over the place. So here, yeah. So each point in this diagram is an S2, so I'm really doing the revolution here. So they're defined in the Pioneer's diagram by r equals pi minus t, which you see that it means that v r plus t, you see, is 2v, from here. So you see that this line, which is just r equals pi minus t on the triangle, just corresponds to v equals to pi over 2 at u fixed. Okay? And v equals pi over 2 just means that basically, the way that I'm getting here, so u fixed means that little u, which is t minus r, is fixed. But t plus r goes to infinity, which means that r goes to infinity. So this is how I'm getting to this surface. And basically, the significance of these guys is, so I do the same for the past guy. So this is this different line, which is, I don't know, minus pi, minus plus t, whatever it is. And for that one, you find that you're sending r to infinity with t plus r fixed. Okay? And their significance is that all the null geodesics start at scry minus and end at scry plus. So this is what they do. Sorry, this is 45. I don't know how I managed to make a 45 like that, but okay. So light rays go at 45 and they start and go like that. Okay, so that's basically the so this diagram basically gives us the causal structure of Minkowski spacetime, and this is what all the geodesics do in it. Now this thing holds for empty space, so we just took Minkowski and did an exact mapping of it to this triangle with the blah blah blah. What happens if you add matter? Because at the end of the day, you don't want to study empty Minkowski. You want to study the fields in presence of matter fields. So in presence of matter, you can still make sense of space like infinity, and of the scries. However, you can still ask for some similar conformal structure on these surfaces and at this point. However, you cannot ask for you cannot be making the requirement that the structure be similar to that of empty space at past time-like and future time-like infinity, because you have stuff sitting there, right? You're putting a person sitting here on a time-like trajectory. You clearly cannot ask for the fields to approach the vacuum over here. Okay? So when one studies, the asymptotic structure of flat spacetimes, one either talks about space-like infinity or these guys. Another thing, another comment that may be useful. So sometimes people draw this diagram a little bit like that. So they make a revolution just to show that you're having a sphere. For scry plus, that's fine because you actually see the sphere. It's actually called the celestial sphere. So it's basically that the S2 that an observer sitting at some time, so it's an S2 that sits at some retarded time U, which is basically the S2 seen by an observer sitting at t equal to U over here and looking at the sky sees. Something like that. So this thing is called the celestial S2. However, this diagram gets very, very wrong. What happens to I0? I0 is a point, as you can see from here. So this diagram is very misleading for I0. But for celestial stuff, it's nice. Another comment is that whereas here conformal compactification of Minkowski space is sort of smooth near I0 if you have empty Minkowski. Once you add matter, you're actually getting some very, very nasty structure close to space-like infinity because the manifold, the conformal manifold will, sorry, the you know what I mean, the conformally compactified manifold is not differentiable close to I0. And there's a good physical reason for that. You see that I0 is basically you're sitting at fixed time and you're looking at infinity, but you're looking at infinity in all directions. That gets represented by just a point on a conformal diagram, but you're really coming from all the possible directions. So you should have some sort of direction-dependent physics if you have a non-trivial matter in your space-time. So this is what. So you have to be very, very careful with this Penrose diagram because you know it's not as simple as it looks. Okay. Okay. So my goal is to get to this board. Okay. We'll see how that goal is achieved. Okay. So now this explains the causal structure of Minkowski spacetime, which is very important. And now we basically want to look at its asymptotic structure near Sky Plus. This is what it's a very rich subject, and this is what people study. And in order to do that. One last thing I want to do, I would like to do is to talk about the isometries of just empty Minkowski. How do they look from the point of view of this Sky Plus? Okay. So what am I doing? Okay. So as I said, in order to reach this Sky Plus, you have to take T and R to infinity with U equals T minus R fixed. Okay? So you're going along a null ray like this. And so you really want to switch to these coordinates, U and R, rather than T. Because you want some things to be finite as you go there. So if I take my Minkowski metric and replace t by u plus r, what I'm getting is ds squared is minus du squared minus 2 du dr. And then you see that the dr squared cancels between the two. So I'm just picking up this. Okay? So this is known as the Minkowski metric in Bondi coordinates. And it's good for studying the structure over here where U is finite and R goes to infinity. And indeed, so we're going to be very interested. So people look very much at what happens to this celestial S2 as you're approaching Sky Plus in this way. And so we want to look at the action of isometries. There's some, so the simplest, so what are the isometries of Minkowski space? Please start to translations. Okay, yeah, indeed, they're Poincaré. So you have some trivial ones like time translations. How do time translations act in this coordinate system? Very good. So basically, you're sending u to u plus constant. So that's simple. A little bit more non-trivial. You can ask, you know, how do, say, space translations look like? And the problem with this, so this is just the z direction, the x3 direction. And the problem with this is that you're stuck to a spherical coordinate system, so the usual translations look very ugly. So if I write x3 as r cos theta, as usual, then dx3 is, you know, dr by dx3 dr plus d theta by dx3 d theta, and so here it's easy. So r is the square root of x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared, and then you go back, and then you see this is just cos theta dr, the first term, and the second term turned out to be 1 over r sin theta d theta. Okay? Is this clear? You're just writing translations in spherical coordinates, and it's a pain. And now, so this is dr at t fixed. But now you want to replace it by dr at u fixed. And basically, that amounts to changing dr to dr minus du. I mean, basically, you're doing this change of coordinates. R doesn't change, but you have to be careful when you write it, so you get this. So basically, you see that in Bondi coordinates, translation just looks like cos theta du with a minus. So it looks minus cos theta du plus cos theta dr minus 1 over r, blah, blah, blah. Okay, but this is the leading term. So it looks like a theta-dependent U translation. That's what it looks like. Okay, and you can notice that this cos theta is actually the m equal to 0 component of the L equal to 1 spherical harmonic. Okay, the reason I'm saying that is that if you do x1 and x2, you're going to find the y L equal to 1 m, all three of them. Okay, so these things, so translations look like just sphere dependent translations in U over here. A little bit more trivial is the action of Lorentz transformations. This is a leading term. Of course, I have 1 over r pieces, but I'm just looking at the leading. This is what I'm interested in. I'm taking r to infinity, and I'm asking how do all these transformations act on the sphere and on u and r, which is going to infinity. So the other thing that one needs to understand is how do Lorentz transformations act on this celestial sphere. And so Lorentz transformations are, x prime mu is lambda mu nu x nu, where lambda is in SO 3,1. And one can write this action on the celestials too very nicely. If one uses so there's an isomorphism that you might have learned a long time ago, between the proper orthochronous subgroup of the Lorentz group. So basically, you want this guy to be positive, and you want the determinant of lambda to be 1. So this guy is isomorphic to SL2C mod Z2. Okay? So SL2C are just 2x2 matrices with complex entries such that AD minus BC is 1. And the way that this guy is supposed to act. So now we need to rewrite this X to some sort of SL2C matrix. The way that you do that, you introduce a matrix X, which is just X mu sigma mu, where these guys are the three Pauli matrices and the identity. So it's something like X0 plus X3, X0 minus X3, and this one is X1 minus IX2. X1 plus IX2. So this is what you're doing. And then you're noticing that the determinant of this matrix is nothing but, minus X mu, X mu. Okay? And so now if you act with SL2C on this X as X goes to SX as dagger, this is actually going to induce a Lorentz transformation. So this will be equal to some, this will correspond to some particular Lorentz transformation whose parameter is determined in terms of this ABCD. Okay? And the reason that there's a Z2 here is because there's an S squared over here, so the sign S and minus S generate the same Lorentz transformation. Okay, so there's some really ugly formula that gives you the parameters inside this lambda, so which is a 4x4 matrix in terms of these ABCDs, but it's completely explicit, and you can find it in some very nice lecture notes on this stuff by Blaze Oblak, 1508, or in the lecture notes. I actually wrote it down, but I don't have time to explain it, but you get the idea. I mean, the idea is just that lambda, you can write it as a function of ABCD. Okay, very good. So, and then that's it. And now, so you want to look at the action of this Lorentz group, which you're representing in terms of an SL2C matrix on the celestial sphere. For that, what you want to do, you want to use stereographic coordinates on S2. So you're all familiar with this projection. So if I put my S2, where you know the usual coordinates are theta and the phi that goes along, and then I put it to touch the origin of the complex plane, and then I draw a line from the north. I won't be able to draw this. Let me make theta bigger. So this is theta. I draw a line from the north pole to this, and I see where it hits the complex plane. That's going to define my z and z bar. And the relationship between z and theta and phi is something like this. Z is e to the I phi cotangent of theta over 2. Okay? And z bar is the complex conjugate. Okay, so the point is that, okay, very good. And then, of course, this theta and phi can itself be related to, you know, x1, x2, x3, r, blah, blah, blah. I mean, you can write it to, related to the Cartesian coordinates. So basically what you're doing, you're doing a Lorentz transformation parameterized in a horrible way by these ABCDs on the Cartesian coordinates. You're doing the map between Cartesian coordinates to spherical coordinates. Then you're doing the map between spherical coordinates to these stereographic coordinates on the sphere. You're taking the limit r to infinity, because otherwise what you're getting is really horrible. And you're finding that in the r goes to infinity limit, the z of the sphere just transforms as a fractional linear transformation with these ABCDs of the SL2C. Okay? So the Lorentz transformations act in a really nice way on the celestial sphere, plus 1/r corrections, of course. And then you can also look at the transformations of the radial coordinates. So r prime is r times some function of z and z bar, plus blah, 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 1/r corrections. U goes to u times some other function, which is actually 1/f of z and z bar, plus corrections. So this is just to check that the r goes to infinity limit is preserved, and that the u being finite is also preserved, which would be important. If your Lorentz transformation took u finite to u infinite, you'd be in trouble. But they don't, and they act super nicely on the sphere. Okay, very good. So this is all I wanted to say about symmetries. So now that we understand everything about just empty Minkowski, we understand its Penrose diagram and you know what things do, and we also understand isometries. The isometries look translations. Okay, so maybe I should write it. Where should I write it? Yeah, just to not forget. So the isometries look like translations are u goes to u plus constant, that's time translations, or u, or something like yl equal to 1 m on the sphere of theta and phi, or zz bar du, and then Lorentz are just this fractional linear transformation on the celestial sphere, sorry, CZ plus D, So this is how the isometries act. Of course, this is a conformal transformation on the celestial sphere. Because if I write the sphere metric, d theta squared plus sine squared of theta d phi squared in terms of dz and z bar, then the metric on the sphere is something like ds squared s2 is 4 dz dz bar over 1 plus zz bar squared, something like that. So you immediately see that when you do a transformation like this, you're just going to pick up a conformal factor. Okay, so these are conformal transformations of the celestial S2. Okay, good. So I'm declaring this a victory. So now we're finally coming to that board. So now I want to define, I want to talk about asymptotically flat spacetimes. So I actually want to put some matter, some radiation in the spacetime to actually do some physics. And the way that people usually do that is by going to some adapted coordinate system. So you're basically choosing a coordinate system that's good near Sky Plus, and then you're trying to study asymptotic metric expansions in that coordinate system. And the coordinate system is known as the Bondi gauge. So I don't really have time to explain how this maybe I should say it some other way. So when we talked about ADS, the asymptotic structure was very clear in this Pfeffermann-Graham gauge. There is an analog of that for asymptotically flat spacetime close to Sky Plus. So for example, you can look, so the people who studied this in the 60s were Bondi, Metzner, Van der Burg, and Sachs. I might misspell this. And for example, you can look at Sachs's paper, and he really explains how physically you reach this coordinate system. I don't have time to explain it. But basically, the idea is that you can just foliate the space-time. So if this is Sky Plus, the idea is that you can foliate, and here is U. You can foliate the space-time by null hypersurfaces, which are labeled by some function U, which you're now using as a coordinate. So they're surfaces of U equals to constant. And then you're assuming that they're null hypersurfaces because this is what it looks like the correct structure of the spacetime is. And from this, you're deriving various constraints on, you know, the metric components. You're deriving that, I don't know, G upper U is zero because this is a null hypersurface, and then blah, blah, blah. And then you choose your sphere coordinates to behave in a certain way as you go towards infinity, and so on. So by just this sort of physical considerations, he shows that you can reach this coordinate system, okay? And the metric in this coordinate system, which is called the Bondi gauge, takes the following general form, is ds squared guu du squared plus 2 gur du dr plus 2 gua du dxa plus gab dxa dxb. Okay? So this is just a gauge choice. Of course, you have to, I should say, it should be, you might think, okay, I have, you know, four functions worth of freedom in choosing my matrix, so I can just fix it in whatever way I want. The delicate part of the game is that, of course, in principle, you have that freedom to fix your diffeomorphism invariance, but you have to do it in such a way that you don't exclude any physically relevant configurations. So that's the problem, and this is why they have to do this very, very carefully. Okay, but this is the gauge. And this is just fixing diffeomorphisms. Okay? So no equations of motion were used. And notice that if we compare this to Minkowski, so Minkowski is just GUU is minus 1, GUR is minus 1. Also, GUA is 0. I should have written in color, and this is just the sphere metric. So this is just R squared d omega 2. Okay? And sorry, I should have said. So you have UR and XAs are the sphere coordinates, as you might get. Okay, good. So this is the choice of gauge. And now what people want to do, they want to impose boundary conditions. So what asymptotic metrics are allowed? And this involves also studying the structure of the Einstein equations, close to R goes to infinity in this gauge, and then they come. So this is called an educated guess that you can read about in Sachs's paper. So you should take this to be minus 1 plus order 1 over R. This is mu R is minus 1 plus order 1 over R squared. This should be 0 plus order R to the 0. And this guy should be, so R squared gamma IB, which is the metric on the sphere, plus order R. So this is having to be consistent with Einstein's equations and also including interesting solutions that were already known to the Einstein equations. But it's basically guesswork. There's no proof, as in the Feynman-Graham gauge, that it always has to look like this. Okay, very good. So then you start solving Einstein equations with these boundary conditions, and the result is on this board over here. So at leading order, you just find the Minkowski metric. And then at first subleading order, So the expansion will involve some arbitrary functions of the retarded time and the sphere, and then you're doing expansion in 1 over r, because r is going to infinity. That's the logic of the expansion. So at order 1 over r, you find some function m of u and the sphere, this mb, b is curly b, it's called the bonding mass. Actually, it's the bonding mass aspect. So its physical interpretation is that if you integrate this guy over the sphere, you get the energy of the spacetime. So for things like Kerr, this is just Newton's constant times the mass of the Kerr spacetime. But more generally, it can have angular dependence, so it's some sort of energy density. And if you integrate it over the sphere, you actually get the energy. And actually, you can show that Einstein's equations force the u derivative of the total mass that you get by integrating this to be negative. So that means if you have radiation escaping your spacetime, the mass decreases, which is physically what you want. This CAB, so this CAB is a traceless symmetric tensor, so gamma AB CAB is 0. So you see CAB is the coefficient that appears as the order R term on the sphere part. So it's traceless symmetric in two dimensions, so it has only two independent components. And these guys, these are basically describing the gravitational waves. Okay, so in particular, one oftentimes defines something called the NAB, which is just the U derivative of CAB, which is called the Newse tensor. And basically, n squared, so NAB squared, is giving you the flux of gravitational radiation out of the spacetime. Okay? So this is where gravity waves reside. And then finally, you have this guy, which appears at the 1 over r term in this du dxa. So this is the next new thing. And this NA is called the angular momentum aspect. Basically, integral over the sphere gives you the angular momentum. Okay, and you see that it sits in the U sphere directions as an angular momentum should. Okay, so you have these three functions that appear, and then everything else is determined via derivatives, and it's super nonlinear, and you can go dot dot dot, but it's really a mess. Okay, but this is sort of the asymptotic structure. The organized, I started late. I'll do BMS in 5 minutes. Okay, very good. So these are the three important quantities that appear over here. But actually they're not fully arbitrary. They also satisfy some equations. So Einstein's equation tell you that the U derivative of MB is related to basically the minus the UU component of the stress tensor. So you have a matter contribution and a gravitational wave contribution. So this is why MB decreases. And then you also have equations for DU NA and so on. So basically at the end of the day, your data is really determined by the news and by the values of, so if this is Scribe Plus, if you look at the past of Scribe Plus, so that's U goes to minus infinity over here, so this MB is determined by the matter and the news up to its value that you define that mu goes to U goes to minus infinity. So you have that value for MB, that value for CAB, and also for the aspect. Okay? So basically this is your data. NAB and the values of the past of Scribe Plus of these other three guys. Okay. And the last thing that I want to introduce is the some decomposition of this CAB. So CAB is traceless symmetric two-dimensional tensor, and it turns out that you can always decompose it something like this, minus two. By the way, these DAs are basically covariant derivatives on the sphere. C plus gamma AB D squared C plus some epsilon C A D B D C psi. So basically you can decompose it in terms of a scalar C and the pseudo scalar psi. So you're having two components. But when you study, so there's some very, very subtle boundary conditions or matching conditions actually boundary conditions that happen at this past of Scribe Plus, which basically set that this psi at U goes to minus infinity is zero. Okay, so actually the full data in CAB is encoded in the news and the past value of this C, which is just a scalar. Okay, good. So now in the last 2 minutes, I can actually talk about asymptotic symmetries. So asymptotic symmetries are just like we did before. You're just looking, you're looking at this asymptotic space-time and you're looking at the allowed diffeomorphisms that preserve the boundary conditions. And you're requiring them to preserve Bondi gauge. So that's actually gonna give you four functions of U and XA. They completely fix the R dependence. When you ask them to actually preserve that asymptotic from the metric, you just find the three functions on the sphere that parameterize these diffeomorphisms. So the diffeomorphisms look like the following. No, maybe I should write them here. You have one set which is parameterized by a function of sphere, T of XA, which looks like T of XC, DU, minus 1 over R, DA of T, DA, plus half DA, DA. This doesn't matter. T, DR, plus blah, 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 trivial terms. And another set of diffeomorphisms that are parameterized by a vector on the sphere, And these are array of x, c, dA, plus, I mean, these are important, but dA array of xc, du plus, okay, some other terms. So the point is that this function t is completely unconstrained. So it's an arbitrary function on the sphere. Whereas these RAs have to be conformal killing vectors. So you have dr rb plus db ra is gamma ab times d dot r. Okay? So basically, the amazing thing that this, so these guys are called BMS, that these BMS people found was that the asymptotic symmetries don't just correspond to the isometries of the vacuum, which are Poincaré, but instead you're getting, so here you see what you're having here is an arbitrary sphere-dependent translation in U. That's what it is. It's an arbitrary sphere-dependent translation along Scribe plus. And so this is an infinite enhancement of the usual translations, which just corresponded to y0 and y1 harmonics on the sphere. Okay. So this is the infinite dimensional extension, and it's really nice. And these guys, well, if you're looking at the globally well-defined conformal killing vectors on the sphere, what you're going to find, there are six of them, which are basically the Lorentz transformations. However, people really like to, you know, just like in the case of CFTs, they sometimes like to look at arbitrary meromorphic functions on, they want to look at holomorphic functions on the sphere, but those guys are not usually well-defined. They're going to have some singular points. But okay, they try to attach some physics to them, having to do with some, okay, in this connection to soft theorems. So those guys, so these guys, if they're globally well defined, they're just Lorentz, the usual Lorentz transformations. If they're arbitrary holomorphic and anti-holomorphic functions, these are called super rotations. And there's a question of current debate whether super rotations should be considered as asymptotic symmetries of flat space or not. The problem with them is that they have these singular points on the sphere, so the associated charges blow up at points, and it's not very clear to what to do with them. However, what everybody agrees on is that the BMS group, which consists of Lorentz plus these guys, which are called super translations, are definitely part of the asymptotic symmetries of flat space. Okay, so that's it. And then, okay, I don't have much time to say many interesting things, but let me say one thing. So it's very interesting to study how these super translations act on just empty Minkowski, okay? So when you're starting to act with these XCTs, with the diffeomorphisms on the asymptotic data, it changes, just like our Ls changed under the action of, you know, of the Virasoros in ADS. And you're seeing that DT, so the change under a super translation of this CAB function that appears over there, is T DU CAB minus 2 dA dB t plus gamma AB dC dC t. T is a function of XA. Okay? And then you have some transformations of the bonding mass aspect and angular momentum aspect. And but the point to notice is the following. So if you start with empty Minkowski, CAB is zero, right? However, when you act with a super translation on it, you're going to generate some non-trivial CAB. I forgot to say something important. You can also look at the algebra of the diffeomorphisms. Super translations commute with each other. Super rotations satisfy the Witt algebra or the SL2 algebra. And the T with R gives you some other super translations. So these guys don't commute. Okay, so so if you act with a super translation on the Minkowski vacuum, you get something with CAB non-zero. However, because super translations commute, and energy is a super translation, I mean it's just a translation without the super, you find that the energy of the super translated vacuum is still zero, so it's still a vacuum. However, so you might say, why isn't this a trivial diffeo? The reason that it's not a trivial diffeo is that it has actually non-zero superrotation charge. It has non-zero angular momentum. So when you act with these T's on the vacuum, you get other vacua. By vacua in the classical theory, I just mean zero energy configurations, but with J different from zero. Okay, and then it's actually interesting to look at how the super translation acts on this scalar field C that I introduced over here. And it turns out that it just acts as delta T of C is just T of X. It acts as a shift. So sort of the physics that's attached to it, so now suppose that you go to the quantum theory, then what you're basically seeing is that you don't just have one vacuum of general relativity in asymptotically flat space. You actually have an infinity of them, which are labeled by basically these CABs or the value of C. But you know, when you go to the quantum theory, you actually have to pick a vacuum. So you're basically spontaneously breaking the super translation symmetry in picking a vacuum. And then this C is basically would correspond to the Goldstone boson of that spontaneously broken super translation symmetry. And from here, given that it transforms as a shift, this is exactly how Goldstone bosons transform. Okay, so this is some of the, rather recently discovered physics that's encoded in these things. And then there are a lot of other things to say. So I have the notes, but I think this was the most sort of important. You get this infinite degeneracy of the Minkowski vacuum. Blah, blah, blah. Oh, yeah, and the last thing I want to mention, you can just read it in Geoffrey's notes or in my notes, it's basically the same, is that you can actually measure the effect of super translations, like physically. The reason being that so the experiment sort of is you're having so two observers that are going on geodesics very close to scribe plus, and they're separated on the sphere, and then there's some sort of gravitational radiation that passes. But it passes only for a finite period of time, from some u initial to u final. Okay? And then the point is that you can basically study the geodesic deviation equation, which gives you the sort of the distance between these two guys. And that geodesic deviation equation gives you some formula for. So you're comparing the distance between these two guys on the sphere before and after the gravitational radiation has passed. And it's sort of a trivial calculation by integrating this geodesic deviation equation to show that this guy is actually proportional to 1 over r, so it's a small effect. Gamma A B delta C B C S C, something like that. Okay, so basically if this C guy jumps between the final and the initial and the final configuration, you can see a displacement, a change of the displacement of the two observers, of the geodesics of the two observers near scribe plus. And the point is that one can easily show using Einstein's equation that the passage of gravitational equation does change this C. So this is actually something measurable, and it's discussed all over the place. But this is a nice physical, you know, actually physical effect of this transformation, and this is known as the gravitational memory effect. So maybe I should stop here, but I should tell you that there's a lot of really fascinating, implications of this.
Yeah. Excuse me, am I audible?
Sorry?
Am I audible? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so why it is called memory? I mean, what does memory stands for here?
Well, because you're here, and compared to here, so the displacement between the two observers knows about the fact that the gravitation has the radiation has passed. So you have some displacement here, then you have some gravitational radiation that hits you, of course, that makes you wiggle and blah blah. Then the radiation is gone. You're again in flat space with nothing around you, but your distance has changed. So you're keeping a memory of the fact that the radiation has passed through you. That's, I guess, the idea.
Okay. I mean, my initial memory has been modified. Is it something related to that?
Well, so if I had time, I would actually derive. So this jump in CBC can be related to the integral of the gravitational radiation or matter radiation flux that passes in this interval.
Okay.
You can see it in Geoffrey's notes or in my notes when they're online.
Okay, yeah. Thanks.
Okay, so I think I'm done. And I'm sorry for you that you won't have any break, but you can have questions. Or not.
Okay, we take anyway.
Okay, we take a 10 minutes break, and then we start with Nikolai's lecture at 11:10.